Dennis Jones was a barber. Dennis had an eighth grade education, and then on that basis, he went on to build one of the largest medical spa franchise companies in the world. He's been a millionaire many times over. He's given millions of dollars away. He's a pioneer missionary, but he had a very rough start in life, and the book chronicles it called Climbing Out of Adversity. Take a look.
Dennis Jones left school at 14 and never went back. One day, Dennis and a neighborhood kid hotwired a car and crossed state lines. They were arrested and sentenced to 9 years in prison. Dennis only served 1 year of his sentence. After his release, he started working in a barbershop and became an award-winning stylist. At 21, Dennis opened the first hairstyling salon in Miami. But the nightlife and drug scene in the early 70s in Miami proved to be too much. Dennis was burning himself out.
Well, you're going to hear the rest of the story now. It's a pleasure to welcome to the 700 Club the author of Climbing Out of Adversity, a good friend. And by the way, a pretty good golfer, too, Dennis Jones. Dennis, good to see you,
buddy. It's good to be here.
How come they gave you such a stiff sentence? You're 14 years old, and what did you do?
Well, I happened to be with the wrong people at the wrong time, and I ended up being one of the wrong people.
Yeah?
And the judge made the statement, I'll never forget, he said, you have pulled a man's crime, and you're going to pull a man's time. They were just fed up, and I got caught in with the rest.
That was it?
That was it.
It's kind of rough for a 14-year-old, that kind of a sentence.
Yeah, it was.
I mean, what did you think? You know, what do you think? You're a kid, and all of a sudden you're going to be locked up with all those hardened criminals.
I don't think I've ever been that scared in my life. Yeah. Reality sort of hits that, you know, the things you're doing, you need to change.
But you didn't know the Lord then. You were just all by yourself.
No, I didn't. I didn't know the Lord. Of course, I got jailhouse religion while I was in jail, but yeah, it didn't last. It wasn't real. But I think a lot of people, when they're in jail, they go to God, but they really don't have a real experience with Him.
Well, you got another judge, though, later looked at the case and figured it was excessive, and he said, time served, you're out, right?
Yeah, you know, it was my first offense. It's the first time I'd ever been in trouble. Mm-hmm. And when I finally went to another judge, he looked at it and he said, asked my mom and dad, are your mom and dad in the house? I said, yes. And they called him up and he said, Mr. and Ms. Jones, take your son home.
That was it?
That was it, and just dismissed it.
Praise the Lord. But that wasn't enough. You went down to Miami and got in the party scene.
I did. You know, I was involved in hairstyling and different things, and I felt Virginia wasn't big enough for me, so I went to Miami Beach and got involved again with things that I'd never done before, and got involved in the party scene, and for a year and a half, was involved in every kind of thing that I could possibly imagine, and I just started burning out.
And then what happened?
I had a friend who I'd worked with asked me to come back and help him with his barbershop, and I came back to Virginia. I was there for a while, and then I opened the first unisex salon in the state of Virginia called the El Matador over in Newport News.
Yeah?
And at that point, a friend invited me to come up into the mountains and sell real estate at Bryce Mountain on the weekends. And I went up there, and while I was up there, the Lord had something in store for me.
What is a unisex hairstyle? I mean, I see it, but that just meant you cut hair for women and men, too? Is that what it meant?
That's exactly right. Well, in the 60s, you might remember, Pat, it was only barbers in beauty shops.
Ah, okay.
And then in 1970, we brought together the two and called unisex, and then we went into hairstyling. That's when the guys started growing the long hair and all of that, if you remember.
And it was a runaway success, what you did.
Yes, it was. It was very, very successful. But things just didn't change until I went up into the mountains. I needed a break. I was burning out even there in Newport News. When I went up into the mountains and finally had an encounter with the Lord, it radically changed my life.
And from then on?
From then on, God had plans.
Well, you do missionary work. You go overseas. What countries have you been to?
Well, into Ghana, West Africa. Matter of fact, a dear friend from Ghana is here today. Mm-hmm. Work in Nigeria and China. Work with the underground church in China for many years. Been working with the Association of International Mission Services and started a ministry so that we could go into these nations and partner businessmen and pastors together to start churches in unreached areas of the world. Oh, that's my vision.
Well, you have also been involved in miraculous things. You've prayed for people and you've seen miracles.
Yes. You know, Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. And the things He said that He would do, we would do also. And it's real if we really come into a relationship with Him to where we really begin to know the Lord and realize that what He said is true. And if we'll move out on that and be willing to experience whatever He has for us in life and take those things until we come to a place of intimacy with Him. Yes. When we stand up and speak, I think we'll see miraculous things. You know, a lot of people believe that all we have to do as far as healings and miracles, if we believe that the devil knows that he's defeated, then we can conquer.
That's right.
That's not quite enough. We have to know that the devil knows that we know that he knows that he's defeated. And when that happens, things really begin to work.
I've got a good friend. I haven't seen him for a few years, Young E Cho. He's got the biggest church in Korea. Amazing man, Paul Young E Cho. And the story you told me that I thought was so funny. You told him, you heard he was coming, I think, here to visit us, and you invited him to play a round of golf. And what did he tell you, and what did you tell him?
We were doing a thing called, I started called Golfing with a Purpose, and we were using the funds for missions.
Yeah.
And so I invited Paul Young E Cho to come over and play golf with us, and he was an avid golfer. So when we invited him, his secretary emails back and says, Pastor Cho said that he would not be able to play, that he has conquered the game of golf, and he's no longer playing.
He's conquered it. He's mastered it.
Mastered it. So I sent him a fax back, and I said, please tell Reverend Cho when he comes, I'll be happy to cast that lying spirit out of him, because nobody masters the game of golf.
So then what happened?
He sent a fax back and said, hey, Reverend Cho will be honored to play golf with you. So we did, and we raised a lot of money for World Missions. It was good.
He mastered the game. That's great. Well, what do you say to business people? You also have a franchise deal that, what do you fix hair, or you have wigs, or what do you do for them?
Well, Pat, after we were putting hair on people for 35 years in the medical hair transplant business, and my wife and I had a network of hair transplant centers across the country, and after putting hair on people for 35 years, we saw a new industry emerging in hair removal. So after putting hair on for 35 years, we started taking it off and started a company called Sona Laser Centers and Sona Med Spas, doing laser hair removal, taking hair off and with Botox and all the other spa services. So we franchised that, and the Lord took that from nothing over an 18-month period of time to the largest med spa company in the country.
It's the largest one in the country?
Well, we sold it in 2004, but in 18 months, it was from zero to the largest med spa company
Incredible.
In the country.
Incredible. Well, what do you see in the church today? You're a pretty good observer of what's going on in the world besides your business. What do you see in the church?
Well, Pat, I'm concerned, quite frankly, in a lot of respects for the church, because I see the church becoming, in many cases, more politically correct than biblically correct in some of the things that they're doing. And I believe that the church is facing the same two issues that the country's facing. And I believe if we lose those issues, that we're going to lose not only our country, the church, and our freedoms.
Yeah.
And I believe those issues are the sanctity of marriage and the sanctity of life. And I believe if ministers do not begin to start really standing up and speaking out against some of the issues that are facing the church, they will lose their right to speak.
Well, they're being attacked by homosexuality, is what you're saying. I mean,
absolutely.
Gay marriage.
Absolutely. And the abortion issue. I mean, the sanctity of life and sanctity. I mean, Jesus came that we might have life, not money, not peace, life. You know, all the others are wonderful, but God's priority is life. And when the church no longer stands up for life of the unborn and the sanctity of marriage, we're in danger.
Dennis, you're a terrific guy. And ladies and gentlemen, the book is called Climbing Out of Adversity. And he's climbed a pretty good way now. And he's a missionary statesman and pioneer and just a terrific guy. So this book's available where books are sold, Amazon, Climbing Out of Adversity. You don't want to miss it. Dennis, it's great to have you.
It's good to see you, my friend.
And I have never mastered the game of golf, as you know when you've played with me, but sometimes we'll get up and hit a few balls together.
Thank you, Pat.
God bless you.
God bless you, my friend.
Dennis Show.